Good morning, colleagues and distinguished speakers and resource persons. I have to confess that trade in services is very close to my heart. During my posting at the Philippine Permanent Mission in Geneva in the 1990s, that was a long time ago, and that was my first foreign posting, I was designated as the lead negotiator for the Philippines, for the new areas, during the Uruguay round of negotiations in the GATT then at that time, including, of course, the new area of trade in services. And I guess I was fortunate to be invited by the chair of the negotiating group on trade in services to be part of the small group of about 20 delegations, 20 negotiators to draft the General Agreement on Trade in Services, or GATS. We would work every day, sometimes even during weekends, during crunch time, for about 2 or 3 years drafting the GATS, until, of course, the draft was adopted and the GATS, the General Agreement on Trade in Services, has become part of the 30 or so agreements in the World Trade Organization, or WTO. Fast forward today, I'm glad that trade in services is now recognized as a major component of global trade. The conversation has definitely broadened to areas that we did not envision before when we were negotiating the GATS. And of course, the GATS, the General Agreement on Trade in Services, remains relevant as a framework of disciplines in the WTO governing trade in services. Today, services have been the fastest growing sector of international trade. Exports of services have grown at 3 times the rate of exports of goods in the past decade, despite being only one fifth of total global trade. However, this exponential growth has been severely disrupted, as the speakers have mentioned earlier, and set back services sectors across the globe, and particularly in developing economies. This sector has been heavily affected by the COVID-19 pandemic and the ensuing economic crisis. But the silver lining is that the crisis has forced us to look to services as critical to sustaining economic activity amid the challenges of the pandemic economy. Because of the impact on economy-wide productivity and trade performance of developing economies, services trade and services policies will be critical to economic recovery and development strategies in a post-pandemic environment. In July, APEC leaders renewed a commitment to working together to facilitate the flow of services, especially those that most support our health and economic response at this critical time. Our distinguished resource persons today have stressed that an innovative, resilient, and inclusive services sector enables developing economies like the Philippines to rapidly build back better in the aftermath of COVID-19. This recovery should be anchored on the following factors, and I'm like putting together the presentations, most of the presentations today. First, the innovation-driven and digitally enabled implementation of the APEC agenda on services. Economies with greater digital services capabilities are better placed to mitigate some of the challenges of the pandemic. They are in a better position to quickly recover from the current crisis and will be more resilient in the face of future shocks and crisis. It is interesting to note that the COVID-19 pandemic has brought a boost to digital services and ICT services sector. This has been mentioned by several speakers. More than 1 in 3 digital service consumers started using these services due to the pandemic, with the rise of teleworking, remote education and e-learning, and telemedicine services. With more people participating in remote work and schooling, and more heavily dependent on the internet for entertainment and social contact, the demand for digital and ICT services has been unprecedented. However, the increased use of online services during the pandemic has accentuated the disparities in technology and connectivity, the need for closer and more meaningful and effective international cooperation to help bridge the digital divide and ensure access to technology and connectivity for all is more important than ever. Second, we cannot overemphasize services' role in a resilient and robust global value and supply chains among APEC enterprises and particularly MSMEs. Disruptions in the global supply and value chain due to the unique challenges of the pandemic highlighted the dependence on services such as distribution centers, freight, retailing, computer services, marketing, and among other manufacturing-related services. APEC played a key role in leading the policy discourse on manufacturing-related services in supply and value chains. This year's APEC Services Competitiveness Report cited the ongoing servification, and I quote, servification of the manufacturing sector, and stressed that further liberalization, as well as stronger policy support and targeted interventions for enterprises, particularly MSMEs, engaged in manufacturing-related services, could propel manufacturers to become more competitive and innovative. This is important for broader inclusive growth prospects, as MSMEs employ between 50 to 80% of the workforce of individual economies of APEC. For the Philippines, it's about 65% of our workforce. Third, increased access to expanded and universal health care for our people is a priority. The hard lesson of the COVID-19 pandemic is that a global health crisis inexorably leads to a global economic crisis. The health services sector has arguably garnered the most attention and in some cases scrutiny throughout the COVID-19 global pandemic, ensuring that our health services sector and healthcare institutions are stable, resilient, responsive in a global or regional health shocks is absolutely indispensable. As a practical matter, domestic healthcare providers and professionals need unfettered access to critical medical goods, such as medical devices, protective equipment, pharmaceuticals, and other products to ensure the appropriate care for and protection of national populations. Much work has already been done at the World Health Organization, at the WTO, at the G20 and other forums to ease export restrictions on such essential medical goods. And APEC can certainly translate this work into concrete action. At some point, we need to dive deeper into the conversation on facilitating long-term cross-border trade in services in the health sector, including the movement of healthcare professionals where they are in short supply, such as nurses, nursing aides, physicians, pharmacists, and other related services. Managed properly and with appropriate safety nets to prevent the so-called brain drain, this could be a potential win-win for developed and developing economies. Indeed, our forum today has been very useful and instructive. I convey my thanks and appreciation to the Asia-Pacific Services Coalition, APSC, and the APEC Business Advisory Council, ABAC, joined by ABAC Philippines and Globe Telecoms, together with the Institute for International Trade at the University of Adelaide and the Australian Department of Foreign Affairs and Trade, for our very fruitful and productive discussions today. We truly appreciate our forum today. On this very challenging APEC year, we have shown that we can manage to maintain a level of ambition, no retreat in our work in APEC, and fulfill the work we have set ourselves. With utmost gratitude to the able shepherding work of our host this year, New Zealand. We join, work, grow together. We are better together. Thank you, everyone, and mabuhay.